The concepts of context and power are important to consider as you examine any intercultural interaction. So in this brief video, I want to highlight some of the reasons why context and power are so important. Context is the physical and social situation in which communication occurs. We need to look at context when examining our intercultural communication because the environment in which the communication occurs can dramatically affect the communicative strategies that are appropriate to utilize. For example, one of my good friends is a county attorney, and I helped him run for office. When we were working on his campaign speeches, he tried to include a lot of humor in them because he's a funny guy and he prides himself on his ability to get important information across to his constituents in a very humorous and entertaining way. So he wanted all of those campaign speeches to be funny and to be entertaining. Using a lot of humor in those contexts is completely appropriate, especially seeing it's a local campaign, so he might not be able to be as humorous were he running for state office or federal office, but at the local level, it was something that was appropriate and very fitting for him. While humor was appropriate in that context, humor would be less appropriate in the context of a eulogy. So were my friend to find himself delivering a eulogy, he would be able to adjust his speaking style, or he'd have to adjust his speaking style, so that he included less humor in the speech. He'd only want to include that humor if he was a humorous story about being involved with that other person, right? Or an interaction that he had that was humorous with the person who passed away. Otherwise, including humor in a eulogy isn't really something that's appropriate to do. The purpose of speaking at a eulogy isn't to entertain, it is to honor the person who has passed away. So what this example reminds us is that context is important to consider when we're looking at intercultural interaction. Context matters in ways that you might not have thought about before. So in looking to context, you do need to think about the purpose of the event, the people who are at the event, the time of day the event happened. But beyond that, you also should look at those social, political, and historical contexts that affect the way the event is occurring or the things that are happening. Take, for example, the diversity march that happened on UWEC's campus last spring. So I had heard that the walk was happening, but I've never heard why the walk was happening. So generically, I heard that there was a message that was posted on the I2M UWEC display board, but I have no idea what the note said. So as I try and interpret this event, I have a difficult time because I don't know the social context in which the event happened. I don't know what was said. So as people talk about the racism that occurs on campus, I don't know what that racism looks like because I wasn't privy to that information within the context. Also, I've only worked at UWEC for a year, so I don't know about any of the campus's past issues with racism. So I was really unaware of those historical contexts that informed the march and why it happened. So as I was trying to understand what was occurring, my lack of knowledge about the context, the social context, as well as the historical context, made that event not only difficult, but also made me interpret that event differently than other individuals might have who were more privy to the information that was found within those contexts that I knew nothing about. So again, this shows us that context is something important to consider when we look at intercultural interaction. Power, as a separate concept, is a state of differential levels of societal and structural privilege. So those people who have more power have greater privilege and greater access to opportunities than people who have less power. Groups that tend to have the greatest amounts of societal power and therefore tend to be more privileged are white, educated, heterosexual, Christian, middle class males. While I was describing a single person there, any person who has one of those identities has privilege in that area. So the fact that you all are soon to be college graduates is one of the ways that you have a privileged identity. You have access to an education that other people don't have access to, or you possess the knowledge from that education that other people don't possess. What we should know about power is that people in power work to create and maintain communication systems that enable them to stay in power. So culturally, men are expected to be aggressive, right? Boys will be boys. Boys are going to fight. Boys can get dirty. That's something that's okay for men to do because it's all right for them to be aggressive, and they actually are rewarded when they're assertive in interaction. While women are expected to be quiet and caring. So because men get to be more aggressive in their communication, they're more likely to ask for raises at work. And this is one of the reasons why we still see a gender pay gap. So right now, women make about 77 cents for every dollar a man makes. So what happens is that men are taught to be aggressive and they're rewarded for being aggressive. So they feel like they can ask for those raises, and then they're rewarded when they assertively ask for those raises, right? Whereas women are taught to be quiet and considerate, so they're less likely to ask for the raise in the first place. And then if they decided they really wanted that raise and they came in and they aggressively asked for that raise the way that their male counterparts did, that woman would likely be branded a bitch and wouldn't get anywhere in her organization. So male assertiveness and female timidity are valued by organizations. The idea behind this is that people in power work to maintain their power. So men, either consciously or subconsciously, enjoy the privileges that are connected to their ability to be aggressive, right? And their ability to communicate in those ways. And so they maintain structures that allow them to be advantaged for doing that and stress that women shouldn't be able to use those same communication patterns as men are. So women aren't rewarded for them in the same way men are. So we work to continue that process so that men can stay in power. Now, again, this isn't necessarily a conscious decision. It's just something that happens in organizations. So when we reward men with the raise while we don't reward women, we're enabling that to keep happening. And so I don't want you to walk away thinking I'm saying this is something people are consciously doing to try and enable certain groups to retain power. That's not necessarily the case. A lot of this is unconscious. But we do have to recognize how these things exist. So communication patterns that allow people to get ahead in the world are things that males can use, while as women aren't expected to communicate in those same ways, and they're not rewarded for communicating in those ways. Context and power are related, as sometimes individuals are given power because of the context in which the communication occurs. So if you were to see me at Target, you'd likely just walk up to me and say hi. You would be the one beginning that interaction. In the context of a classroom, however, you give me the power to determine when and where people can talk. So someone has to raise their hand and then they're going to be called on in the classroom context. But again, outside of that context, you don't give me that same power or that same influence because you wouldn't be uncomfortable just coming up and talking to me. While some people have more power and privilege than others, it doesn't mean that there aren't things people can do to try and get more power or try and gain more access to privilege. For example, people can hold marches and rallies to advocate for greater support, of abolishing rape culture, for example. In the end, when we look at power, we need to be sure that we're always thinking about how systems of privilege and disadvantage affect our interactions. So as we process what occurs and what has occurred in our intercultural interactions, understanding both context and power are very important. We're going to talk more about these concepts throughout the semester. And please let me know if you have any questions about what we've covered today or what was in the textbook concerning context and power, because both of those are very important in the different papers that you'll be writing throughout the semester. So learning to recognize how and why context matters and how and why power and privilege operate are going to be two things that we're going to spend a lot of time this semester working on. Again, let me know if you have questions.